Climate change is cooking the world's corals, right? Well, we know that the Great Barrier Reef is doing rather well with record amounts of coral, but the Great Barrier Reef is in water quite a bit cooler than the coral reefs around the equator. Maybe that coral is being cooked. So we'll have a look at a bit of the data in a minute. But we actually sent reef rebel Leonard Lim, who is a professional diver and cameraman, to check out Raja Ampat to look at the coral there. This area is part of what we call the coral triangle because it has the most diverse coral on Earth, but it's also an area which has got about the hottest water on Earth.
So there is a lot of news about how the warming climate is killing the Great Barrier Reef. And according to the fragile reef hypothesis, the Great Barrier Reef is very sensitive to increases in water temperature. It implies that the corals are near or at its thermal limit. Slight increases in water temperature will result in widespread coral bleaching or mortality. This hypothesis implies that coral reefs are very fragile ecosystems that can easily be disrupted by change. Similar species of corals thrive in much warmer seas, especially in the coral triangle, where corals grow much faster in hotter temperatures. So while I'm traveling to West Papua, Raja Ampat in Indonesia, I'm keen to find out what makes this place the highest recorded marine biodiversity in the world when it's so much hotter. Well, no surprises, the water's really warm here, averaging about 30 degrees Celsius. In fact, reefs across Raja Ampat experience temperatures fluctuating between 19 and 36 degrees Celsius, with many individual reefs exposed to whopping 6 to 12 degrees Celsius variation within a single 24-hour period. This extreme temperature variation has led Raja Ampat's corals to evolve remarkable heat tolerance. By forming symbiotic relationships with heat-resistant zooxanthellae and through genetic adaptations, these corals are able to thrive despite the challenging conditions.
Now, unlike many ecosystems on the land, marine ecosystems, especially tropical East Asia, are connected. Coral spawn that is released moves around in the currents for many days or even weeks or even months in some cases, so it may settle hundreds of kilometres away. Heat-tolerant coral from Raja Ampat won't be able to get to Australia in one hop, but it can do it in a few hops. So it shouldn't be surprising that the corals in this region are often very similar or even the same species to what we get on the Great Barrier Reef, and even parts of Thailand for that matter. By comparison, land-based fauna and flora in Australia is totally different from anywhere on Earth because we've been cut off from the rest of the world by the deep water ocean between Australia and Indonesia.
Here in Raja Ampat, the amazing marine biodiversity is boosted by the extraordinary variety of marine habitats. From shallow coral gardens to deep underwater walls, the region's complex topography combined with strong ocean currents bringing constant supply of nutrients is also an important factor. These diverse habitats create microenvironments where different species can thrive, contributing to the region's unmatched biodiversity. The strong currents also bring in a steady supply of nutrients, further supporting the growth and resilience of these corals. As a result, Raja Ampat not only serves as a sanctuary for marine life,
but also plays a critical role in replenishing and sustaining coral reefs throughout the coral triangle.
Thanks, Leonard. Okay, so it was utterly stunning, the coral that he documented there, but it was only a small spot. So is it representative of the rest of the coral in the region? Well, it turns out there is quite a bit of data from that region. It's nowhere near as comprehensive as for the Great Barrier Reef, and it doesn't go back very far in time. And here it is. This is the official data from the Global Coral Monitoring Network, and it shows that the amount of coral in this region is basically the same as it always was. Note the bands represent the uncertainty. So although you may think that there might have been a little bit of a peak around 2010, once you take into account the uncertainty bands, you'd be very brave to say there's any real difference across that whole period. By the way, the uncertainty is largely due to the changing methodology that they used on how that data was taken. I won't go into the details. Now look, the Coral Triangle, which aside from patches of the Red Sea and the Persian Gulf, is the hottest water on Earth, pretty much where corals are going to live, and the coral is doing fine. And we shouldn't be surprised, because corals grow faster in hotter water. They're a hot water species, and they've been around for a few hundred millions of years, and for most of that time, the world has been a whole lot hotter. It's been hotter even just a few thousand years ago. 1 or 2 degree temperature change, which is all that's predicted for the tropics at most, is just nothing for the corals.
Hey, it's Leonard. I'm just editing the last bits of the video. Hope you enjoyed this coral footage from Raja Ampat. It's been an absolutely amazing trip. And I'll just like to add some last comments. I'd like to point out that I did observe coral mortality, as you would with any ecosystems, even one as pristine as Raja Ampat. Also, having dived in quite a few places within Southeast Asia and the Great Barrier Reef, it's interesting to note that while Raja Ampat is named the Mecca for diving and even called the Last Paradise, it's unfortunate that the Great Barrier Reef has copped so much bad press, suffering a constant barrage of doom news about how badly bleached the corals are. Well, in my honest opinion as a diver, I think the best spots within the Great Barrier Reef are not in any way lacking, and I truly find both ecosystems just as amazing.